Broadcasting across California. California's only statewide political show. You're watching The Issue Is.
And welcome to The Issue Is. I'm Elex Michaelson. Sometimes we say we've got an all-star panel. This week, we've really got an all-star panel. Debate issues like abortion, January 6th, Governor Newsom, and more. With us, on the left, our most frequent guest, Gloria Allred, who's been involved with more high-profile cases than perhaps any other person alive. And on the right, nationally syndicated radio host and columnist and author Larry Elder, who's got like seven jobs right now. In 2021, he finished first in the recall election amongst Governor Gavin Newsom's challengers.
Right.
Welcome to you both. Gloria, you were on last week. I don't think we've ever had anybody on 2 weeks in a row. But Larry, when we booked you, you said you wanted to be on with Gloria.
Absolutely.
You guys have a very special relationship.
I've known Gloria probably almost 30 years, and this may take a lot of the steam out of the show, but I've always adored her. She and I used to be on the same station. She'd be on for 2 hours. I would drive in. I was on the 2 hours after her. She'd say something that would tick me off. I'd come in, and I'd confront her, and she'd say, let's do it on the air. So we'd take it on the air. And I remember one time, Gloria, I asked you, would you please ask Maxine Waters why she won't come on my show? I invited her many, many times, and to her credit, Gloria asked Maxine Waters why she wouldn't come on my show. And Maxine Waters said, I don't come on those shows of entertainers. They're just entertainers. And Gloria said, well, Larry's more than an entertainer. I think you ought to do it. To this day, she's not. But Gloria's always had my back. I've danced with Gloria before. You'll see it again. She thinks she can dance. She really can't. And also, Gloria, you danced with my brother, my late brother, Kirk. I don't know that you know. He died a couple years ago.
Oh, I'm sorry.
And he was a Democrat like you, and he adored you. So Gloria is a wonderful person. She's funny. She's got a risque sense of humor. Put a camera on her, she becomes Cujo. So
and you guys have nicknames for each other, right?
I call her Super Glow.
And you call him?
The Sage from South Central.
There we go. All right, well, you ready to go at it again? I know it's been a few years since you guys have
Let's begin
with the big issue of abortion rights. President Biden signing an executive order at week's end. We've got some video of that. The country is still coming to terms with the Supreme Court overturning Roe v. Wade and returning the abortion question to the states. About half the country now looking to ban abortion. California looking to expand abortion rights. Larry, did the court get it right?
Yeah. Well, the court got it wrong in 1973 when they took up the case in the first place. And as you pointed out, all it does is return it to the states where it should have been in the first place. And a lot of people have said the Supreme Court has now outlawed abortion. They've done no such thing. Again, they've returned to the states the way it was for all but 50 years of our nation's history. And some of the biggest protests have taken place in New York, Chicago, and L.A., where it's zero chance that the local legislators are now going to change the law and make abortion rights more restrictive. And I also take issue with people like Gavin Newsom who claim that this is all about men exerting power over women. Depending upon the polls and how they phrase them, a greater percentage of women are pro-life than even men. So it's nonsense to say this is about men controlling the lives of women.
Gloria, I know you disagree with that.
Absolutely, I do, Alex.
I'm shocked.
Larry, you know, it is about the United States Supreme Court throwing out precedent, throwing out super precedent, but it's also about controlling the lives of women. It's about coercing women who become pregnant and requiring them to take that pregnancy to term, even if there are health risks, even if they are victims of rape or incest. What about that 10-year-old child recently who became pregnant and couldn't get a legal abortion now in Ohio because of the Supreme Court ruling and the law in Ohio that was passed, and had to travel to Indiana to get a legal abortion. Soon in Indiana, it may not even be legal to get an abortion. This is outrageous. Women cannot enjoy full equality and liberty because of this U.S. Supreme Court decision giving states the right to make abortion perhaps a crime or illegal.
You just misstated the law. You said even if there are health risks. Even the Catholic Church recognizes abortion in the event that a woman's life is in peril. So that's just not true.
Well, the Supreme Court does not recognize it because they, from the moment of fertilization, this recent U.S. Supreme Court decision in Dobbs versus Jackson means that a state can pass a law that even if it would endanger the life of a woman to get an abortion, a state can outlaw abortion, even in that case.
You've misstated the law.
There is no
state that requires an abortion if the woman's life is at risk. Not a single one. It will never happen. And this Dobbs decision said that beyond 15 weeks, an abortion is illegal. That is more restrictive than in Italy, than in France, countries we often look to for how we ought to model ourselves. This just returned the issue to the states where it should have been in the first place. And there weren't protests in the streets before 1973. There weren't rallies in Washington, D.C. before 1973. The Supreme Court federalized an issue that they never should have touched, and now it's just gone back to the states where it should have gone before.
Gloria, why shouldn't it be a states' rights issue? Because obviously the views in a place like California are very different than a place like Mississippi.
Well, I mean, should contraception be a states' rights issue? Should marriage equality be a states' rights issue? And should it be a national law that prohibits abortion in every state? That's what Mitch McConnell wants to do. That's what many Republicans want to do. And no, I don't. It should be a right and not subject to a state interfering with the right of a woman to control her own body.
I don't know any Republican who wants a federal law that says abortion should be illegal. I don't know anyone who wants one.
Well, Mitch McConnell
has advocated for that. Mike Pence has said that should be
yes.
something.
And you also talked about this being a super precedent. So what? Dred Scott was precedent. Plessy v. Ferguson was precedent. So cases are wrong, and when they're wrong, they need to be overturned.
Do you disagree then with an idea of a national abortion law passed by Congress?
I do disagree with that. It should be a state by state issue. And if you guys want to codify Roe v. Wade, you should do it the right way, which is to push for an amendment to the Constitution. And people on the right who want to codify outlawing abortion should do the same thing.
You think that 10-year-old should have been forced to take that pregnancy to term?
I do.
Even though she's obviously a victim of rape, a 10-year-old cannot consent to sex.
It's still an innocent life, and that's the distinction.
Oh, this is disgusting.
If I believe that this is an innocent life and you don't, we're never going to come to an agreement. And so that's why it should be fought state by state.
Somebody that's gotten a lot of attention after this is Justice Clarence Thomas.
Yes.
He suggested that the right to privacy, which was at the core of the right to abortion, shouldn't also be in place for things like marriage equality or contraceptives. And Larry, I know you have an issue with how the media has been treating Justice Thomas
It's been hideous. He's been referred to as an Uncle Tom by Benny Thompson, the head of the January 6th committee. He's been called an Uncle Tom by Joy Reid of MSNB Hee Haw. He's been called Uncle Tom by Samuel Jackson. It's outrageous. You can disagree with somebody without making a racist slur like that. I think it's unfair what he's been called. Look, I like Clarence Thomas. I think he's a superstar, and more clout in the Supreme Court is going to Clarence Thomas. And he's right. There are a lot of precedents we ought to rethink, including especially the one that allowed race-based preferences that Justice Sandra Day O'Connor signed.
Do you think, though, that same-sex marriage should be overturned?
I think that should be an issue, a state-by-state issue, just as well as this should be an issue,
Interracial marriage.
Don't give me that. That's based on the
14th
Amendment.
I haven't said anything. It's
a red herring.
Yeah. What about
it's a black herring?
What about
African American herring?
What about interracial marriage? I notice that Justice Thomas did not mention that.
Did not mention
the U.S. Supreme Court decision of Loving versus Virginia. He's in an interracial marriage.
Yeah,
Perhaps that's the reason he didn't mention it. But that is also based on a fundamental right to marry. And that is a constitutional right and also rooted in liberty in the 14th Amendment.
It's rooted in the 14th Amendment, which Roe v. Wade was not.
It was
rooted in a right to privacy, which does not exist in the Constitution. I've read it a few times. It's not there. The 14th Amendment is there. For you to act as if this now means they're going to rethink interracial marriage is nonsense. Furthermore, as you pointed out, he's in an interracial marriage. He's going to sign a decision that says my marriage is illegitimate. Doesn't even make any sense.
Exactly, and that's the point. He can't get pregnant, and therefore he doesn't seem to have
I thought men could get pregnant.
He doesn't have
any regard. Now all of a sudden they can't get pregnant
for
anymore.
For women, and the life-changing impact of this decision on their lives.
If you think that interracial marriages are protected by the Constitution,
by the 14th Amendment,
why are same-sex marriages not protected by that as well?
That should be done on a state-by-state basis.
What's the difference?
There are maybe 18 or so items in the Constitution, Article 1, Section 8, that's the province of the federal government. And same-sex marriage is not one of them. Abortion is not one of them. Those kinds of things should be left to the people and to the states. Interracial marriage is based upon the 14th Amendment, equal protection, and those are not.
Okay. Last word, Gloria, and then we're going to wrap
things
up.
Yeah, I mean, I've read the Supreme Court decision, and, you know, it talks about the fact that Roe was based on the 14th Amendment and liberty in the 14th Amendment, which was ratified in 1868. You know, the majority says by the people, but the people at that time were white men who ratified it. And they weren't taking into account the people who are called women whose lives are affected by this recent Supreme Court decision.
Real quickly, Larry.
Being too wonky, even Ruth Bader Ginsburg said that the Roe v. Wade decision was improperly decided. It should have been based upon the 14th Amendment. It was not. It was based upon a right to privacy, which does not exist in the Constitution.
Well, she supported the right to choose abortion.
She supported
May she rest in peace. Don't make her turn over in her grave, please.
All right.
She did not agree with the
rationale. We're going to leave it there. Up next, though, more with Larry and Gloria. We're going to talk about one of your favorite topics, Larry, Gavin Newsom. But we go to break with one of your favorite songs, Gloria. This is a chance, of course, for you to dance, show off your move. Here's a clip from one of Larry's favorite movies, Seeing Allred on Netflix. We'll be right back. Take it away, Gloria and the Dancing Drag Queens.
It's Independence Day, so let's talk about what's going on in America. Freedom, it's under attack in your state. Your Republican leaders, they're banning books, making it harder to vote, restricting speech in classrooms, even criminalizing women and doctors. I urge all of you living in Florida to join the fight, or join us in California.
So that's the ad that the California Governor Gavin Newsom's campaign spent about $100,000 to air on the 4th of July in Florida. It got more than 3 million views on Twitter, a lot of free national publicity for a guy who insists that he has no interest whatsoever in running for president at all. Sub-zero interest. And yet he's running ads in Florida. Back with our panel, Gloria Allred and Larry Elder. Of course, Larry, you ran in the recall election last year. You finished first among his challengers. Mm-hmm. This week, one of the big stories was that the governor was on vacation. I have some video of this. Emily Hoven of CalMatters was first to report that Newsom spent the week on a family vacation in Montana. It's a special state for the Newsoms. They got married at a ranch owned by Jennifer's parents there. They even named their first daughter Montana Newsom. Yet some of the governor's critics are blasting him for that trip. California currently bans state employees from traveling to Montana for official business due to what the state says are Montana's policies towards LGBTQ people. Right. Newsom's team won't discuss whether he brought with him a taxpayer-funded security detail. They're sort of suggesting that he did. Mm-hmm. Gloria, do you care about this? You think too much is being made about this, this whole thing?
I think it's a fair issue, but what is more important is what the governor's stands are and the policies that affect us in California. And I'm fine with his going to, his running ads in Florida as well. Florida, you know, which doesn't want young children to be able to say gay or discuss gay in their classrooms. And that's why in the Pride Parade right here in West Hollywood last month, I had a car that said, "In L.A., we say gay. In L.A., we say gay." And it had a photo of the state of Florida, and everybody got it.
I guess Larry probably wasn't at that parade with you.
I don't think I was there. I wasn't invited. My invitation got lost in the mail.
What's your take on the Montana trip?
Well, none dare call it hypocrisy, even though that's exactly what it is. He does not allow California officials to travel there on state business. This wasn't state business, I'll give you that. But one would think if the state is so repulsive because of their laws on abortion, he wouldn't spend time there. This is just as hypocritical as him being in that French Laundry restaurant, not wearing a mask, not engaging in social distancing with the very people that drafted the mandates that he was violating. His own kid enjoying in-person private education while banning in-person private education for other people. During the campaign, I was asked over and over again about the Texas fetal bill law. And I asked the media people that asked me that, please ask Gavin Newsom, at what point does he believe a pregnancy has gone too far, that he would outlaw it? Is pregnancy okay up to the point of birth? Ask him that, and no one ever asked him that. Only 6% of Americans believe a pregnancy should be legal up to birth. That is the position of Gavin Newsom, and he wasn't called out on it. He's a hypocrite.
I'm getting flashbacks to the recall campaign. I feel like we're back at it again.
Where I was called the black face of white supremacy by the LA Times.
There we go, got it in. So yeah. Do you think, though, that maybe it's time to rethink these travel bans in the first place? That the whole idea of it is, seems like it's kind of a messaging thing, but in reality doesn't really make sense.
No, I think it's important. For example, I said on the abortion issue recently in my column in Variety that I think that SAG-AFTRA and the Directors Guild and the Producers Guild and other guilds and the entertainment business should all agree that they're not going to produce films in states that ban abortion.
Wow.
And I think that's what we should have. And I think others should not do business with states that ban abortion. Now, if somebody has a family member in a state that bans abortion and wants to visit them, I don't have any problem with that. Or even take a vacation there because their family is there. But come on, we don't want to put money into states that are going to put women and girls' lives at risk.
Gloria, do you have any respect at all for people that feel differently? Any respect at all for people that feel that abortion is wrong, it's a sin? And for the women that feel that way, including Amy Coney Barrett, do you have any sympathy at all for people that feel that way?
You know, what I'm concerned about are state laws coercing women into having to take pregnancies to full term, even if it's a risk to their health, even if it's going to cause financial problems for the woman, even if it's going to interfere with their educational opportunities, their business, their job.
Wow.
That's what I am concerned about. We're way beyond the discussion of should we have choice choice.
We're also way beyond the Newsom discussion because now we're doing abortion again. Okay. But let's get back to that. Larry, last time that you were on our show was right after the recall election. And you said that you weren't going to be running this year because essentially you thought that it was too difficult for a Republican to win in this state given the fact that they're 2-1 Democrats in this state.
Actually, 3-1 you throw in the independents.
So Brian Dahle is the guy that's now running against Governor Newsom, state senator. Does he have any shot? And are you going to be supporting
him? You know, before the show, Gloria and I were talking about Brian Dahle. She didn't even know who he was. And I didn't know who he was until he ran. He's got zero name recognition. He's got zero money. He's got zero shot.
Okay.
He got 1.1 million votes. He got 1.1 million votes in this primary election. I got 3.5 million in the recall election, three times what he got. He's got no shot. This is a state where the battlefield is daunting. We're outnumbered, meaning Republicans 3-1. Half the state are independents. Even the New York Times said independents in California vote Democrat.
Well, I think this state is very progressive, obviously, not something that Larry likes. I love it. I love it that we are leaders in the environmental field. We are leaders in protecting minorities from discrimination. We are leaders in education. And that's why it's great that the governor is going to other states and talking about, you know, freedom and rights. And maybe that'll inspire voters in other states to know that that's possible.
Gloria,
to come to California, they can bring their money here and we'll show them that, you know, what a state should be
I've got to say something. You say we are leaders in education. I'm assuming you mean higher education. You can't mean K through 12 or government schools. You used to be an inner city school teacher. You know what's happening here. Mm-hmm. 75% of black third graders can't read at state proficiency levels. Half of all third graders in California cannot read at state proficiency levels, and the math scores are no much better. Yeah. How can you say we are leaders in education? Education being the first step towards leaving poverty.
Well, you know what? We can always do better,
but we
are still leaders in education. Well, and that's why, it's another reason people should
move
here.
And the UC system is one of the great systems in the world.
We're also leaders in homelessness. People are also leaving the state for the first time in 170 years.
Larry, the last time you were on, you suggested that you are not going to run for governor, but you might run for president.
I think you said president, but I said I might run for something else.
Are there any thoughts about that?
I'm looking at it. I've got a political action committee called Elder for America. We're looking to take back the House and the Senate, campaigning in favor of school choice, get rid of these soft on crime DAs. We got rid of Bodine. We're going to try and get rid of Gascon. And we also want to campaign for strong families.
Yeah.
Well, can I ask you a question in your political career? Are you interested in an endorsement from former President Trump?
You know what? I did not seek an endorsement from him when I ran, but I was still called a Trump wannabe, Trump light. Gavin Newsom said I was more Trump than Trump, whatever that means.
That didn't answer my question. I said, are you interested in an endorsement?
Well,
in the future,
if I were to run for president, I believe that Donald Trump is going to run for president. So I doubt that he'd endorse me, his opponent.
But if he doesn't, and you do, would you be interested?
Absolutely, I would. I voted for him twice. I campaigned with him and for him.
Yeah.
I don't think of him as a hideous person the way a lot of other people do.
Larry's just Trump-like. We're
going to talk more.
I like his position on immigration. He supported school choice. Best economy ever. He did the First Step Act that allowed black prisoners to rethink their...
And what about January 6th?
Let's talk about January 6th when we come back.
At some point,
we have to take a commercial break.
The insurrection of January 6th.
So we're going to talk about that. Who knows? Maybe it'll be Newsom versus Elder on the presidential stage in 2024. That'd be something. We go to break with more music and an opportunity for each of you to dance. Well, this is some Crosby, Stills, Nash & Young. Hopefully we can make this loud here. This is Love the One You're With. Because the two of you, I think you love the one you're with right now.
Whoa. I'm super glow.
Whoa.
We'll be back. More of the Issue is after this. White House counsel, former White House counsel Pat Cipollone, testifying to the January 6th committee behind closed doors this week. Next week, we're expecting two hearings, one on Tuesday, possible primetime hearing on Thursday. Back with our panel this week, our all-star panel, Larry Elder on the right, Gloria Allred on the left. Larry, have the hearings made you think differently at all about Donald Trump?
No, they haven't. The purpose of the hearings is to bring down his poll numbers, hopefully to deter him from running again in 2024, to get the nomination, and if he does, to make him lose. That's the whole purpose of it. And in my opinion, it's having some effect. I'm finding a growing number of Republicans saying, you know, we like Donald Trump, but I don't think we want the baggage. They weren't saying that before these hearings. It's had that effect. But the idea that there was some sort of insurrection that was orchestrated by Donald Trump is incredibly unfair. What part of, I want you to peacefully and patriotically march over to the Capitol building, don't you understand, which is what he said hours before these riots. And they were riots. And the people that did them should be punished to the fullest extent of the law. I don't know anybody that endorses this. But the idea that he ordered it, orchestrated it, led it, is absolute nonsense.
Agree with that, Gloria?
With all due respect, it's absolute nonsense to think that he didn't have a major role in all of this.
I didn't say he took
hours, even after his daughter was asking him to please ask the rioters, I want to call them the insurrectionists, to go home. He didn't. Why? Because he was pretty happy that they were down there. In fact, he had invited them to January 6th. He spoke to them on January 6th. He said he was going to go to the Capitol with them, which he didn't, but only because the Secret Service wouldn't drive him there. He wanted those election results to be overturned. He wanted to stage, Alex, a coup to make sure that Biden did not become president. This is a man we have to know the full truth about, and we are going to learn more next week when there are more hearings for the January 6th committee.
Well, I'll tell you what. I will make a bet with you right now that he was not going to be indicted for insurrection. He's not going to be, despite what Adam Schiff said, saying he's incontrovertible evidence that he committed insurrection. He will not be indicted because the evidence isn't there. Benny Thompson, the chair, also said we're not going to make a criminal referral. Cheney disagreed with that. She said we can and should make a criminal referral, and they don't need to make one. The DOJ is investigating right now, hasn't brought a single charge of insurrection against Donald Trump, and they will not because the evidence is not there.
Okay, well, here's the operative word. It's three letters, yet. In other words, the Department of Justice has not yet brought charges against Donald Trump. They may.
They won't.
Or they may not.
They won't.
But I know, well, you have a crystal ball we don't have.
I have it in my trunk. I should have brought it in.
If I have one, it's a little bit foggy. So all I can say is you're right that the January 6th committee does not need to make a criminal referral. It's fine if they do. It's fine if they don't. But what matters is we are all entitled to the truth.
Can I concede Gloria's right that Donald Trump thought the election was stolen, wanted it overturned, just as Democrats thought the election was stolen in 2000 and objected to electors, 2004 objected to electors, 2016 they objected to more states than Donald Trump did in 2020.
Some did, but it was not at the same extent. You'll agree to that, right? I mean, well, Hillary Clinton went to Donald Trump's inauguration, shook his hand, did a concession speech, and did not present a slate of phony electors.
She didn't use the C word concession, nor did Donald Trump use the C word. But Donald Trump is in Florida, and Joe Biden is in the White House. To act as if the Donald Trump was not going to leave is silly. So, Hillary filed a lawsuit in 2016. She joined the lawsuit that Jill Stein filed to overturn the results in Wisconsin and filed a separate lawsuit to have the thing counted by hand. So this idea that Hillary hasn't filed lawsuits is not true.
Well, I didn't say that, but having said that, talk about lawsuits. So glad you brought it up, Larry, because 60 lawsuits claiming fraud in the election of Joe Biden. Yes.
He lost them.
Donald Trump, with Rudy Giuliani, lost every one of those 60 lawsuits. Many Trump appointees, judges,
agreed.
Throughout the
lawsuit. He lost the lawsuits.
Why?
What's wrong with hiring a lawyer to make legal arguments that you think are valid? He lost.
Yeah.
Nobody said he didn't lose.
But who loses 60 lawsuits in a row?
Who suppresses the Hunter Biden story that had gone through, he would have been elected. Who does that? Why don't you care about that? Hunter Biden's story was suppressed by Facebook, by Twitter. They wouldn't even let the New York Post put their own story on.
I'm sure if the Republicans win the House, we'll hear a lot more about the Hunter Biden story in the years ahead.
Why is it dismissed like this? This thing broke days before the election. Joe Biden said adamantly he knew nothing about his son's business dealings.
Last
it turns out he did.
The story was suppressed.
So just to wrap things up. So back to where we started with this whole thing. You're still comfortable voting for Donald Trump if you don't run yourself.
Let's see. As opposed to Kamala Harris or Joe Biden. Yes.
Yes. And obviously.
Emphatic yes.
What about obviously. If I run?
Three letters.
Could we bring America together
and have the Allred Elder ticket?
Three letters, to quote my opponent, Y-E-S, yes.
Okay. All right.
Well, yet was the word I
We
had.
Are going to be back with Larry and Gloria. And I want you to think about this. What is your favorite thing about each other? Larry, we're going to talk about that when we come back. But first, we go to break with more music. This is Smokey Robinson, You Really Got a Hold on Me, which I think is also synonymous for your relationship. You Really Got a Hold on Me. Yeah. Jam out. You ready to move? Come on, Larry. Welcome back to The Issue Is. We are with Gloria Allred and Larry Elder after one of our best debates ever. Here on The Issue Is. But what I love about this show is that it shows that people who disagree don't have to be disagreeable with each other, that they have respect for each other. I know the two of you have a lot of love for each other. What's your favorite thing about Larry, Gloria?
Well, Larry, of course, is a great debater. He's wrong, but he's still a great debater.
Yeah. Larry, your favorite thing about Gloria?
A couple of things. Gloria had a marvelous relationship with her father. You speak about him like he walks on water. That's how I felt about my father. We're both lawyers, both trial lawyers. Both of us had did radio shows. Both of us had TV shows. We played court TV judges. We have a lot in common. I just adore her. She's sweet. She's funny. She's personable. As I said before, I put a camera in front of her, and she goes mad dog. I don't know why.
But she's also a great dancer. And, you know, she started
She thinks
dancing.
She's a great dancer.
She is a great dancer. Don't
great
you ever
dancer.
Insult yes. Gloria's dance moves yeah. to me, okay? Gloria started the tradition of dancing on
That's
this
right.
show, which started back on week three of the show. 4 years later, we're still dancing. But this is going to be the epic, because, Larry, you're one of the best dancers we've ever had on this show.
Well,
so now we get to bring the two of you together to one of your favorite groups, The Temptations. So here we go. We're getting ready, and we're going to end with this. Let's see your guys' dance moves. Oh, yeah.
See, she's leading.
Yeah. Larry's not used to women leading.
That's right.
You gotta get used to it, Larry. This is it. 2022. Lead, follow.
Lead, follow.
Or
get out of the way.
Out of the way.
Gloria Allred, Larry Elder, ladies and gentlemen. We'll see you next week for more of The Issue Is.